Part 1 of Acres of Diamonds. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Acres of Diamonds by Russell H. Conwell, Part 1. When going down the Tigris and Euphrates River many, many years ago, with my party of English travelers, I found myself under the direction of an old Arab guide whom we hired up at Baghdad. And I have often thought how that guide resembled our barbers in certain mental characteristics. He thought that it was not only his duty to guide us down those rivers and do what he was paid for doing, but also to entertain us with stories, curious and weird, ancient and modern, strange and familiar. Many of them I have forgotten, and I am glad that I have, but there is one I shall never forget. The old guide was leading my camel by its halter along the banks of those ancient rivers, and he told me story after story until I grew weary of his storytelling and ceased to listen. I have never been irritated with that guide when he lost his temper as I ceased listening, but I remember that he took off his Turkish cap and swung it in a circle to get my attention. I could see it through the corner of my eye, but I determined not to look straight at him for fear he would tell another story. But although I am not a woman, I did finally look, and as soon as I did, he went right into another story. Said he, "I will tell you a story now which I reserve for my particular friends." When he emphasized the words "particular friends," I listened. I have ever been glad I did. I really feel devoutly thankful that there are 1,674 young men who have been carried through college by this lecture, who are also glad that I did listen. The old guide told me that there once lived not far from the River Indus an ancient Persian by the name of Ali Hafed. He said that Ali Hafed owned a very large farm, that he had orchards, grain fields, and gardens, that he had money of interest, and was a wealthy and contented man. He was contented because he was wealthy, and wealthy because he was contented. One day there visited that old Persian farmer one of those ancient Buddhist priests, one of the wise men of the East. He sat down by the fire and told the old farmer how this world of ours was made. He said that the world was once a mere bank of fog, and that the Almighty thrust his finger into the bank of fog and began slowly to move his finger around, increasing the speed until at last he whirled this bank of fog into a solid ball of fire. Then it went rolling through the universe, burning its way through other banks of fogs and condensed the moisture without, until it fell in fields of rain upon its hot surface and cooled the outward crust. Then the internal fires bursting outward through the crust threw up the mountains and hills, the valleys, the plains, and prairies of this wonderful world of ours. If this internal molten mass came bursting down and cooled very quickly, it became granite. Less quickly, copper. Less quickly, silver. Less quickly, gold. And after gold, diamonds were made. Said the old priest, "A diamond is a congealed drop of sunlight." Now that is literally scientifically true, that a diamond is an actual deposit of carbon from the sun. The old priest told Ali Hafed that if he had one diamond the size of his thumb, he could purchase the country. And if he had a mine of diamonds, he could place his children upon thrones through the influence of their great wealth. Ali Hafed heard all about diamonds, how much they were worth, and went to his bed that night a poor man. He had not lost everything, but he was poor because he was discontented, and discontented because he feared he was poor, he said. "I want a mine of diamonds," and he lay awake all night. Early in the morning, he sought out the priest. I know by experience that a priest is very cross when awakened early in the morning. And when he shook that old priest out of his dreams, Ali Hafed said to him, "Will you tell me where I can find diamonds?" "Diamonds? What do you want with diamonds?" "Why, I want to be immensely rich." "Well then, go along and find them. That is all you have to do. Go and find them, and you will then have them." "I don't know where to go." "Well, if you will find a river that runs through white sands, between high mountains, in those white sands, you will always find diamonds." I don't believe there is any such river. Oh yes, there are plenty of them. All you have to do is go and find them. And then you have them, said Heli Hafed. I will go. So he sold his farm, collected his money, left his family in charge of a neighbor, and away he went in search of diamonds. He began his search very promptly, to my mind, in the mountains of the moon. Afterwards, he came around into Palestine, then wandered on into Europe, and at last, when his money was all spent and he was in rags, wretchedness, and poverty, he stood on the shore of that bay at Barcelona in Spain when a great tidal wave came rolling in between the pillars of Hercules, and the poor, afflicted, suffering, dying man could not resist the awful temptation to cast himself into the incoming tide, and he sank beneath its foaming crest, never to rise in this life again. When that old guide had told me that awfully sad story, he stopped the camel I was riding on and went back to fix the baggage that was coming off another camel. And I had the opportunity to muse over his story while he was gone. I remember saying to myself, why did he reserve that story for his particular friends? There seemed to be no beginning, no middle, and no end, nothing to it. That was the first story I had ever heard told in my life, and it would be the first one I ever read in which the hero was killed in the first chapter. I had but one chapter of the story, and the hero was dead. When the guide came back and took up the halter of my camel, he went right ahead with the story into the second chapter, just as though there had been no break. The man who purchased Ali Hafed's farm one day led his camel into the garden to drink, and as that camel put its nose into the shallow water of that garden brook, Ali Hafed's successor noticed a curious flash of light from the white sands of the stream. He pulled out a black stone, having an eye of light reflecting all of the hues of the rainbow. He took the pebble into the house and put it on the mantle which covers the central fires and forgot all about it. A few days later, this same old priest came in to visit Ali Hafed's successor, and the moment he opened that drawing room door, he saw that flash of light on the mantle, and he rushed up to it and shouted, "Here is a diamond. Has Ali Hafed returned?" "Oh no, Ali Hafed has not returned. And that is not a diamond. That is nothing but a stone we found right here in our own garden." "But," said the priest, "I tell you, I know a diamond when I see it. I know positively that is a diamond." Then together they rushed out into that old garden and stirred up the white sands with their fingers. And lo, there came up other more beautiful and valuable gems than the first. Thus said the guide to us, and friends, it is historically true, was discovered the diamond mine Galconia, the most magnificent diamond mine of all in the history of mankind, excelling the Kimberley itself, Kohinoor, and the Orloff of the crown jewels of England and Russia. The largest on earth came from that mine. When that old Arab guide told me the second chapter of the story, he then took off his Turkish cap and swung it around in the air again to get my attention to the moral. Those Arab guides have morals to their stories, although they are not always moral. As he swung his hat, he said to me, "Had Ali Hafed remained at home and dug in his own cellar or underneath his own wheat fields or in his own gardens, instead of wretchedness, starvation, and death by suicide in a strange land, he would have had acres of diamonds. For every acre of that old farm, yes, every shovelful afterward, revealed gems which since have decorated the crowns of monarchs." When he had added the moral to this story, I saw why it was reserved for his particular friends. But I did not tell him I could see it. It was that mean old Arab's way of going around a thing like a lawyer, to say indirectly what he did not dare say directly, that, in his private opinion, there was a certain young man then traveling down the Tigris River that might be better at home in America. I did not tell him I could see that. But I told him his story reminded me of one, and I told it to him quick. I think I will tell it to you. I told him of a man out in California in 1847 who owned a ranch. He heard they had discovered gold in Southern California, so with a passion for gold, he sold his ranch to Colonel Sutter, and away he went, never to come back. Colonel Sutter put a mill upon a stream that ran through that ranch, and one day his little girl brought some wet sand from the raceway into their home and sifted it through her fingers before the fire. And in that falling sand, the visitor saw the first shining scales of real gold that were ever discovered in California. The man who had owned that ranch wanted gold, and he could have secured it for the mere taking. Indeed, $38 million has been taken out of that very few acres since then. About 8 years ago, I delivered this lecture in a city that stands on that farm, and they told me that a one-third owner for years and years had been getting $120,000 in gold every 15 minutes, sleeping or waking, without taxation. You and I would enjoy an income like that if we didn't have to pay an income tax. But a better illustration, really, than that occurred here in our own Pennsylvania. If there is anything I enjoy above another on the platform, it is to get one of these German audiences in Pennsylvania before me and fire that at them. And I enjoy it tonight. There was a man living in Pennsylvania, not unlike some Pennsylvanians you have seen, who owned a farm. And he did with that farm just what I should do with a farm if I owned one in Pennsylvania. He sold it. But before he sold it, he decided to secure employment collecting coal oil for his cousin, who was in the business in Canada, where they first discovered oil on this continent. They dipped it from the running streams at that early time, so this Pennsylvania farmer wrote to his cousin asking for employment. You see, friends, this farmer was not altogether a foolish man. No, he was not. He did not leave his farm until he had something else to do. Of all of the simpletons the stars shine on, I don't know of a worse one than the man who leaves one job before he has gotten another. That has a special reference to my profession and has no reference whatever to a man seeking a divorce. When he wrote to his cousin for employment, his cousin replied, "I cannot engage you in business because you know nothing about the oil business." Well then, the farmer said, "I will know," and with most considerable zeal, characteristic of the students of Temple University, he sat himself at the study of the whole subject. He began away back at the second day of God's creation, when the world was covered thick and deep with that rich vegetation which has since turned into primitive beds of coal. He studied the subject until he found that the drainings really of those rich beds of coal furnished the coal oil that was worth pumping, and then he found out how it came up with the living springs. He studied until he knew what it looked like, smelled like, tasted like, how to refine it. Now, he said in his letter to this cousin, "I understand the oil business." The cousin answered, "All right, come on." So he sold his farm, according to the county record, for $833, even money, no sense. He had scarcely gone from that place before the man who had purchased the spot went out to arrange for the watering of the cattle. He found the previous owner had gone out years before and put a plank across the brook back of the barn, edgewise, into the surface of the water just a few inches. The purpose of the plank, at that sharp angle across the brook, was to throw over to the other bank a dreadful-looking scum, through which the cattle would not put their noses. But with that plank there to throw it all over to one side, the cattle would drink below, and thus the man who had gone to Canada had himself been damming back for 23 years a flood of coal oil, which the state geologist of Pennsylvania declared to us 10 years later was even then worth $100 million to our state. And 4 years ago, our geologist declared the discovery to be worth to our state $1,000 million. The man who owned that territory on which the city of Titusville now stands and those Pleasantville valleys had studied the subject from the second day of God's creation clear down to the present time. He studied it until he knew all about it, and yet he is said to have sold the whole of it for $833. Again and again I say, no sense. But I need another illustration. I found it in Massachusetts, and I am sorry I did, because that is the state I come from. This young man in Massachusetts furnished just another phase of my thought. He went to Yale College and studied mines and mining, and became such an adept as a mining engineer that he was employed by the authorities of the university to train students who were behind in their classes. During his senior year, he earned $15 a week for doing that work. When he graduated, they raised his pay from $15 to $45 a week and offered him a professorship. And as soon as they did, he went right home to his mother. If they had raised that boy's pay from $15 to $15.60, he would have stayed and been proud of the place. But when they put it at $45 in one leap, he said, "Mother, I won't work for $45 a week." The idea of a man with a brain like mine working for $45 a week. Let's go out to California and stake out gold mines and silver mines and be immensely rich. Said his mother, "Now, Charlie, it is just as well to be happy as it is to be rich." "Yes," said Charlie, "but it is just as well to be rich and happy, too." And they both went right about it. As he was an only son and she was a widow, of course he had his way. They always do. They sold out in Massachusetts, and instead of going to California, they went to Wisconsin, where he went into the employ of the Superior Copper Mining Company at $15 a week again, but with the proviso in his contract that he should have an interest in any mines he should discover for the company. I don't believe he ever discovered a mine, and if I am looking in the face of any stockholder of that copper company, you wish he had discovered something or other. I have friends who are not here because they could not afford a ticket, who have stock in that company at the time this young man was employed there. This young man went out there, and I have not heard a word from him. I don't know what became of him, and I don't know whether he found any mines or not, but I do not believe he ever did. But I do know the other end of the line. He had scarcely gotten out of the old homestead before the succeeding owner went out to dig potatoes. The potatoes were already growing in the ground when he bought the farm, and as the old farmer was bringing in a basket of potatoes, it hugged very tight between the ends of the stone fence. You know, in Massachusetts, our farms are nearly all stone wall. They are obliged to be very economical in front gateways in order to have some place to put that stone. When that basket hugged so tight, he set it down on the ground and dragged on one side and pulled on the other. And as he was dragging the basket through, this farmer noticed in the upper and outer corner of the stone wall right next to the gate, a block of native silver 8 inches square. That professor of mines, mining, and mineralogy knew so much about the subject that he would not work for $45 a week when he sold that homestead in Massachusetts, sat right on that silver to make the bargain. He was born on that homestead, was brought up there, and had gone back and forth rubbing the stone with his sleeve until it reflected his countenance and seemed to say, "Here is $100,000 right down here just for the taking." But he would not take it. It was in a home in Newburyport, Massachusetts, and there was no silver there, all way off. Well, I don't know where, and he did not, but anywhere else, and he was a professor of mineralogy. My friends, that mistake is very universally made, and why should we even smile at them? I often wonder what has become of him. I do not know at all, but I will tell you that I guess, as a Yankee, that he sits out there by his fireside tonight with his friends gathered around him, and he is saying to them something like, "Do you know that man Conwell who lives in Philadelphia? Oh yes, I have heard of him. Do you know that man Jones who lives in Philadelphia? Yes, I have heard of him too." And then he begins to laugh and shakes his sides and says to his friends, "Well, they have done just the same thing I did precisely." And that spoils the whole joke, for you and I have done the same thing he did. And a while we sit here and laugh at him, he has a better right to sit out there and laugh at us. I know I have made the same mistake, but of course, that does not make any difference because we don't expect the same man to preach and practice too. As I come here tonight, I look around this audience and I am seeing again what through these 50 years I have continually seen men that are making precisely that same mistake. I often wish I could see the younger people and that the academy had been filled tonight with our high school scholars and our grammar school scholars, that I could have them to talk to. Well, I would have preferred such an audience as that because They are the most susceptible, as they have not grown up into their prejudices as we have. They have not gotten into any custom that they cannot break. They have not met with any failures as we have. And while I could perhaps do such an audience as that more good than I can do grown-up people, yet I will do my best I can with the material I have. I say to you that you have acres of diamonds in Philadelphia, right where you now live. Oh, but you will say, you cannot know much about our city if you think there are any acres of diamonds here. I was greatly interested in that account in the newspaper of a young man who found that diamond in North Carolina. It was one of the purest diamonds that has ever been discovered, and it has several predecessors near the same locality. I went to a distinguished professor in mineralogy and asked him where he thought those diamonds came from. The professor secured a map of the geologic formations of our continent and traced it. He said it either went through the underlying carboniferous strata adapted for such production westward through Ohio and the Mississippi, or in more probability came eastward through Virginia and up the shore of the Atlantic Ocean. It is a fact that diamonds were there, for they have been discovered and sold, and they were carried down there during the drift period from some northern locality. Now who can say but some person going down with his drill in Philadelphia will find some trace of a diamond mine yet down here. Oh, friends, you cannot say that you are not over one of the greatest diamond mines in the world, for such a diamond as that only comes from the most profitable mines that are found on Earth. End of part 1.